5, sir.
Card, please.
10.
Card, please.
20. Blackjack.
Blackjack is the game. Nearby, there's the big wheel. Craps. And roulette. It's here in Miami. And strictly legal. It's Miami Dice. A new school, says the company's brochure, offering courses to prepare folks who want to learn. Pat Morgan is training director. He has over 20 years in the business.
Dealers here, or the instructors here, can sit and talk to them and discuss the different methods of playing. And, of course, they can't do that in the casino. The casinos there want to get their money. We don't want to get their money. We don't want either win or lose. It's just paper play money we're using anyway. And it gives them a feel for what they're going to get when they go into the real thing.
Simple courses at $60 teach the individual how to play and bet. But for about $700, you can be trained to audition for a job in a casino aboard ship or in Vegas or Atlantic City or the Bahamas.
Place your bets, please.
Miami Dice is not taking a stand on the gambling issue in Florida.
Sorry, sir, you're over.
But they say they can get workers ready just in case.
Well, if the people feel that it's going to come to Florida, it'd be a good idea for them to be, you know, first knocking at the door saying, I'm a qualified dealer, can I have a job, please?
Card.
13.
Card.
21.
Not too bad. Morgan figures that dealers in the Bahamas and in Nevada and New Jersey can earn $25,000 a year plus tips.
Okay, let's go.
Miami Dice has opened. The outfit says it provides seminars for people interested in learning how to play games like craps, blackjack, roulette. And they say there is a comprehensive course available that would train someone to work in a casino. That's what got Alan Cantor in here.
I'm going to take a blackjack seminar for a night, so I plan on participating.
How much is that going to cost?
Somewhere around $600, $6 to $8.
Well, it sure does look like a casino, doesn't it? After all, it's got tables and chips and cards and wheels and... This is Florida, where for the moment at least, casino gambling is illegal. And for the moment, the state's Department of Education says Miami Dice has no business being open. The state charges the outfit is an unlicensed trade school, and Miami Dice illegally has outlawed gambling equipment. There are lots of signs on the walls that say gambling is not permitted. And the director of training, Pat Morgan, says everything here is on the up and up.
Because there's no money changing hands at all. It's just paper money, it's play money. The chips have no value. Nobody wins or loses. They just have a good time and enjoy themselves.
And how about the roulette wheel and the cards and the dice and the chips themselves?
They're just teaching implements as far as we're concerned. They're just showing people what they would expect if they go aboard a cruise ship or go to the Bahamas.
And what about plans to train people for casino jobs without a license?
We heard from Tallahassee saying, please don't use the word school. So we dumped all those brochures, and we're having new brochures made up with the word seminar on them. These are just gaming seminars, like you have seminars for real estate or to become a nail technician or a plumber or something.
Well, some officials of the state education department told me they're going to have a big powwow Monday morning. Then they might go to court seeking an injunction to shut this place down. Alan Mendelson, News 4. Miami Dice, July 25th. It was open for business as a school. For around $600, they teach you to run a blackjack game or a craps game or roulette. Miami Dice today. The police swept chips into garbage cans, folded up the gaming tables, and carried them away. The owner was served with a warrant. The state says it's illegal to have gambling equipment, even if Miami Dice said it was for instruction only.
That's correct. We're not charging them with gambling or with operating a gambling house. It's just possession of gambling equipment.
As soon as Miami Dice opened, the state wanted the place shut down on various charges. First, that it did not have a license as a vocational school. Second, that it had gambling equipment. But Pat Morgan of Miami Dice told me that night everything was legal.
Because there's no money changing hands at all. It's just paper money, it's play money. The chips have no value. Nobody wins or loses. They just have a good time and enjoy themselves.
And how about the roulette wheel and the cards and the dice and the chips themselves?
They're just teaching implements as far as we're concerned. They're just showing people what they would expect if they go aboard a cruise ship or go to the Bahamas.
Late today, Pat Morgan shrugged his shoulders and said a court will have to decide who's right. Miami Dice might be betting that attitudes have changed. Well, back in the old days, the Miami Police Department would have destroyed the goods. They would have smashed the craps tables and the roulette tables, but not now. They'll hold the goods until the trial is over, and then maybe return it all. Alan Mendelson, News 4.
She couldn't cook anyway. You know, the dog didn't die. He committed suicide.
The film is called Nothing in Common. Gleason plays an aging garment salesman whose wife of 34 years walks out on him.
So,
Mom left.
Tom Hanks plays his corporate executive son who comes to his rescue.
Now, you probably wondered why I called you together today.
He called us together to help kick off the movie's national media campaign. It was a press conference in Fort Lauderdale where Gleason lives.
Why did I become a comedian?
Gleason says he's proud of the movie because it's got comedy and drama, but none of the cheap theatrics usually associated with the films of summer.
We don't have any stuntmen. That's for openers. And there's only one little car crash.
That he did himself.
Yes.
And Gleason's isn't the only film this summer that doesn't rely on flashy stunts to grab its audience. Take a look at some of the movies that are out now. This just could be the season when the summer movie comes of age. They aren't just chopping each other up this summer. There are more literate offerings like Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
I do have a test today. It's on European socialism.
Even though this is a teen movie, it does deal with issues a bit more weighty than adolescent discovery.
Logan, are you going to sleep with her again or not?
Then there are adult comedies like League of Legals and How About okay? About Last Night.
I mean, I don't care if you call me. In fact, don't.
It's a movie about romance and commitment, and it's getting rave reviews. One critic calls it the carnal knowledge of the 80s. So why are we getting better cinematic fare this year? Well, Nothing in Common director Gary Marshall, who brought us Laverne and Shirley and Happy Days, thinks he knows.
When the summer, everybody's hot and sweaty, and they just want to laugh, and that's it. I think somebody came up with that theory, and enough comedies came out in a row where they said the audience, we don't want to laugh that much and that often.
He lives and works in this quiet house. The word charlatan graces his door. Now that means a pretender to knowledge not possessed, which is understandable when you meet Jim the Amazing Randy. He's a magician and an escape artist, and the first to admit his feats only look real.
Ah, but I am an actor playing a part, and I make that very plain. I don't say that when I make the young lady float up in the air that she's floating there by any supernatural means. I say this is an illusion.
And that's the difference between Randy and the charlatans he investigates from his home office. You see, Randy is founder of the Committee for the Scientific Investigation of Claims of the Paranormal. In other words, he specializes in uncovering fakes and frauds.
Those files that you see there have everything in them from Armageddon to vampires and beyond. I literally have investigated dowsers, people who find water underground, or hope they can, but seem to always fail when I'm around.
And who are his favorite charlatans to investigate? The faith healers.
Some of the faith healers think they're real, but none of them ever bother to follow up on the healings. For example, Popoff and Grant have used the gimmick of seating people who can walk, although it may be with a cane, seating them in a wheelchair that they've never been in before in their lives. And we question them afterwards, after they spring up out of this wheelchair and walk at the demand of the reverend who comes down the aisle at them. They say, gee, I was never in a wheelchair before in my life. You mean that isn't your wheelchair? Oh, no, he asked me to sit in it.
It's for this reason the Amazing Randy was awarded the MacArthur Cash Fellowship, not because he can do magic tricks, rather because he knows the tricks behind them.
Sleight of hand is great. It's marvelous stuff. It's great entertainment for and by magicians. But when it enters religion, when it enters philosophy, when it enters a rational world and attempts or claims to be real, then we're in big trouble. After all, the Tooth Fairy and the Easter Bunny aren't too difficult to disbelieve in, but I don't know. What about Santa Claus? There's an awful lot of evidence for it.
John Holden, News 4.
It's no accident that Deer Park Spring Water is giving out samples in South Florida health clubs. After all, many health-conscious Americans are switching to bottled water. Here's what we're swallowing. At last measure, Americans have gulped down bottled water at the rate of 900 million gallons a year. That's more than double the rate of 5 years ago. As you might guess, Californians lead the way. They drink about 13 gallons per person.
California has the highest per capita consumption in the country. About 45% of all bottled water is sold in California. Florida is a strong second, and the per capita consumption in Florida is over 7 gallons per person. Texas is third, New York is fourth.
The business in South Florida is worth about $60 million a year. On average, we spend about 79 cents a gallon. Sure, water is cheap, but the rest costs money.
A good 40% is in packaging and raw material cost, factory cost.
Here's a breakdown. What costs 79 cents in a store probably costs the supermarket 59 cents at wholesale. The water company probably spent 49 cents. By the way, bottled water outsells imported sparkling water by about 5-1. And all types of water make up the fastest growing category in supermarket sales.
When the world is filled with all those strange and mysterious things called natural laws, like the law of physics and the law of gravity, isn't it nice to know there's always someone around to explain them?
If you lean forward, you go fast. You lean back, you go slow, okay? Even though this is spinning round and round fast, the ball will go straight across and back if you do it right. That's the idea. Make it perfect. Good, good, good. Good, good, good.
All day long, Alex Haust explains things at the Museum of Science. In fact, that's the name of his job.
Explainer, which is precisely what I'm supposed to do. Explain.
And admittedly, there's a lot to explain here. At any one time, there's 150 different exhibits on display dealing with the basics of science, from why a whisper carries across a crowded room by means of an echo dish to why a curve in a mirror will distort your image. And if you don't understand, you can count on Alex to explain.
If you roll this ball here, it's going to go in the hole. If you roll the ball from here, it's not. Now, why? Because our floors aren't level in Florida. Why isn't Florida's floors level? Because all of Florida's built on swampy land.
Now, haven't you always wondered about that? And if Alex can't explain, well, there's 8 more explainers here who can.
You know, I've always wondered why some of my stories can be such a hair-raising experience. And now there's an explanation. What is the explanation?
See, that explains everything. John Holden, News 4.
Remember when bathing suits used to look like this? Well, this is how they're going to look next year. The theme of the show was nostalgia, and that's just where the suits of summer 87 are headed, back to the past. There is swimwear dressed up in the day glow colors of the psychedelic 60s. There are also throwbacks to the innocent 50s. The days of two-piece suits and beach blanket bingo. In fact, the two-piece is expected to make a big comeback next year. Less, maybe more, but in the summer of 87, more will be in.
Body fitness. You don't have to go and show it at all anymore. If you've done it, they know it, and go for it.
But for those of you who do want to bear it all, don't despair. There'll be something for you next season. How about a little number like this? That is, if you can figure out how to put it on. If slinky suits you, the look is definitely cutouts. In fact, some of these suits are barely there. Those that are gussied up in glitter, like these designs from the Miami swimsuit firm, the Twins. The folks who this summer gave us the swimsuit that changes its color in the sun have now gotten a case of jungle fever.
The glitz is hot, the shiny, the bright, the wonderful, exciting glitz, but also the safari.
Jungle, safari. Animal, sexy.
She's been an object of desire ever since the solid gold replica of the Statue of Liberty was made early this year. Art collectors wanted to pay $1.5 million to possess the 70-pound solid gold lady. Americans were expecting to see her on a grand tour of the States during the Liberty birthday celebration. And thieves spent 18 hours with blowtorches trying to get their hands on her. The owner was relieved to find that they hadn't melted her down. Though that attempt failed, it did kill any immediate sale or grand tour.
We got some problem with our insurance companies after what happened, and then it was not possible anymore to do it, unfortunately, and we regret that.
The owner and insurance company are still worried about the thieves, so much so that we can't tell you what bank the statue's in, but they claim they're not worried about buyers, even though the Liberty celebration is over.
I will take the example of a painting for Mr. Rembrandt. He died a long time ago, and his painting continued to rise in value and in interest. It's going to be the same situation with that gold statue.
Christian Nome hopes the statue will still take a grand tour of the country, either with himself or the new owner, but I doubt if any of you will get close enough to pat her on the stomach. It was 1.5 before. Has it gone down? Has it gone up?
Well, the tendency will will be up, sure.
Nome claims to have 4 serious prospective buyers, 3 in the United States and 1 in Europe. Ed Odell, News 4.
It seems people are taking their tunes everywhere these days, to the park, to the beach, now even to the operating room. You're probably wondering why 13-year-old Michelle Elsner is wearing a Walkman during her operation. Well, it's a newfangled pain reduction technique called music therapy.
Let the music act as a little magic carpet that's going to take you far away to any of those places that you want to be this morning.
Before her surgery to fix a curvature in her spine, Michelle had a session with Miami Children's Hospital music therapist Sammy Siegel. Tranquil tunes like these were played in Michelle's ear. And Sammy instructed her on how to use that music to relax.
I want you to let the music travel all throughout your body.
The headphones stay on as Michelle is wheeled to the operating room. The music continues until she is fully sedated. Then Michelle will get her headphones back in the recovery room. The whole idea of music therapy is to reduce the pain after surgery.
Postoperatively, when they come back to their rooms, they know that when they put on the music and they think about those feelings of relaxation, they can achieve much more comfort.
Sammy has been using the music to help children at the hospital for 3 years, and Michelle's parents say she definitely hits the right note.
I'm very impressed by it. Our other daughter, Allison, who had a similar operation earlier this year, was part of this music therapy program. And every time she was in discomfort or had some shots to be taken care of, she looked for her music.
Does this really work?
No question about it. We've had significant reduction in the amount of drug that's needed after this procedure using music therapy.
Actually, John, the carpet is blue, where the president will stand tomorrow night on the mezzanine of the Hotel Intercontinental, formerly called the Pavillon.
People still consider this the Pavillon Hotel in Miami. Outside of Miami, it's not very well known, but now it will be known as the Intercontinental.
The cost of being known was creating a presidential suite in just 12 working days.
It was finished yesterday, which, to my knowledge, must be a record. I know our company's never done it so fast before.
To be crass about it, how much did this effort cost you?
The total cost was $150,000.
The Secret Service wouldn't let us take pictures of the presidential suite, but we did manage to talk to the interior designer.
It is in Palladian style, which is an empire style. And it is very gracious.
And very expensive, $4,000 a night, if you or I were paying for it. Senator Hawkins gets a substantial discount.
It's around $1,000.
But then the senator is also paying for fancy hors d'oeuvres and drinks for about 100 fat cats who will pay up to $9,000 each, and 1,000 more paying $1,000.
The money is being split between Senator Hawkins and between the state party. I would say that probably $500,000 will be raised, and that she would get $250,000, and the state party would get $250,000.
But thousands will pay nothing to see the president at a party in the lobby modeled after this one at the Republican convention.
It'll be pandemonium here tomorrow, about 7,000 people jammed into this lobby cheering President Reagan, who will be up there on the mezzanine. Right beside him, Senator Paula Hawkins, trailing Governor Bob Graham by 11 points in the polls. She wants to remind voters that a vote for her is also a vote for the president. Michael Putney, News 4.
Hello, sweetheart. Yes.
Welcome to Persuasions. You might call it the Elizabeth Arden of the cat world. Here, fat cats get to have their nails done, ears washed, and their locks lathered. At Persuasions, they can even persuade Kitty to endure the heat of a giant blow dryer that puts that hairstyle right in place. Owners get to wait in the Victorian-styled sitting room. Kitties waiting for their appointments get to sit it out in a specially designed cat chalet. The whole works cost $16 for short-haired cats, $23 for long-haired. Owner Debbie Lumsden says it's South Florida's first salon for cats only.
I think they deserve to have a place to come and be pampered, just like the dogs do. The poodles. So here it is.
The test kitchen at Burger King is behind a locked door for authorized personnel only. This is where the new Whopper was developed and where Burger King broiled steak was tried and failed. Now, after an investment of over $100,000, Burger King won't say just how much, the company is ready to try French toast sticks. There are five in a box with a special secret syrup.
A dripless syrup.
That's Burger King Vice President John Winkler.
You don't drip it on your tie. And especially for children, when they dip in the syrup and pop it out and put it into their mouth, the syrup clings to the French toast stick.
So we gave it the test. By September, this will be ready to eat in or take out all around the country.
Still not dripping. It works.
Imagine French toast while driving down I-95, syrup and all.
Shake it. It's still not coming off.
And now the ultimate test. Will it drip and spot my tie? Well, not for a while at least. How do they do it?
That's information that is secret to Burger King.
But Winkler does say their syrup has fewer calories than regular maple syrup. He also says that the test kitchen is used to revise and update products. Take French toast sticks.
We changed to add some cinnamon to the product, a very flavorful element. We changed the piece size on a number of occasions, and we changed the batter on a number of occasions.
Jeff Cummins walks into this gym, a button-down, upwardly mobile real estate lawyer. He will come out a contender. This is Jeff's idea of a workout. He comes to the Verrick Gym in Coconut Grove during his lunch hour, opting for a boxing bout at lunchtime instead of a three martini lunch. And he's not alone. The guy at the bag is criminal lawyer Vinny Flynn. In the ring, former boxer and now insurance mogul Bobby Dykes. Over here is a TV producer, and this guy owns his own boat maintenance business.
And why are these guys doing it? Well, they tell me that duking it out is a great way to reduce midday stress.
I just came from what I would call a terrible business meeting. When I go back to the office, I'm not going to remember anything about what happened before, and that's the way I want it.
Why boxing? Why not aerobics or a spa?
I like violence. I like to hit people.
I enjoy being hit more than I enjoy hitting, and that's a problem I've had.
It sure is. 3 weeks ago, Steve's nose was broken during one of these lunchtime bouts, but he doesn't plan to throw in the towel.
I don't think there's any person outside the gym that thinks I'm sane. They all think I'm crazy to do it, but, you know, I keep coming back. After I box three rounds, I'm in here sparring. I feel wonderful.
And apparently, a lot of ordinarily sedate business executives feel that way. Folks here at the gym tell me yuppies with a passion for prize fighting in their spare time make up 10% of the customers, working out right alongside the guys who want to be real fighters.
Nothing is like being in the ring for a fight. And compared to that, aerobics, jogging, swimming is basically a joke.
It's the ultimate challenge. It's just you against him. It's not like a football game where you rely on other teammates. It's just you against him in your hands, and that's it.
Big Bold Gold is in. Fancy handcrafted chains and bracelets in 14-carat and 18-carat. As much as 3/4 of the price of this stuff is the craftsmanship, the steady, detailed work. And just when it's popular, sticker shock looms. Gold prices are starting to go up for the first time in about 2.5 years. Here's why. Investors are putting more money in gold now that interest rates are low. And the threat of a cut in South African mining is also pushing up prices. Now add in one more factor, the price of labor. Skilled hands are getting more expensive in Europe and here. Samuel Goetz is vice president of Mayer's Jewelers.
As far as costs here, the biggest problem that we foresee in purchasing in this country is the fact that prices are being driven through labor costs, and that is, you know, unions driving prices up. The American workers demand a lot more money, and it makes it very tough for the domestic people to remain competitive.
There is also a shortage of skilled hands. Workers here are paid as much as $15 an hour, sometimes more. And the skill comes after many years of school and personalized training. Some of the finest craftsmen come from Europe because the American industry is young. This artist is from France.
I've been apprentice in a small shop, and you're making the practice. That means old guy is teaching you, showing to you a lot of things, and you go to school.
tell us run. Don Johnson, this is called Heartbeat.
I don't care what you say, you can give it away. Your money don't mean much to me.
Yes, folks, that really is Don Johnson, the song called Heartbeat, the title cut from his new album, and it was all over South Florida airwaves today.
Well, I guess Don Johnson was the hottest topic in South Florida. How about some reaction?
I think he's just capitalizing on his fame and fortune.
Well, it doesn't hurt to be Don Johnson with a song, but I think the song will do real well. And it should be a number one song.
You really think so?
You know, he paid me a couple of bucks for this last week. No, I think it's going to be a good song, I really do. Maybe not number one, but definitely top 10.
Well, I wanted to find out what some people in the street thought of the new song, so I took my Don Johnson cassette to a mall and played it for some very surprised shoppers.
That's pretty good. Who
you
is
like it?
Yeah.
Don Johnson.
No.
Yes.
I think you should stay in acting.
Stick to Miami Vice. Don't sing.
If it comes out as good as he looks, it's got to be a hit.
It's the 1986 Christmas gift show, and it's meant to tease yuppies with goodies to go yummy yummy. For example, chocolate-covered potato chips in dark chocolate and white chocolate. Save these for your better friends.
They're going to be on the small box, $5 in the store, on the large box, about $18.
And for your better girl, a chocolate rose.
Part of the yuppie movement is to buy better things. The gourmet food fits into that area.
Yuppies like cats, so meet Earl the Dead Cat. It comes with a death certificate and lots of reasons to own.
Well, because you don't have to feed it, you don't have to get a litter box for it. He doesn't go out in the middle of the night and chase other cats, and he doesn't howl when there are other cats around.
And then we have here,
a device
that repeats everything I say. It's called Peat and Repeat. Yuppies will understand that inside there is a computer chip tape recorder.
Shut up.
Also, for the yuppie exec, there are neon Lucite telephones. And for the executive, there is an attaché case that opens to reveal a pool table. Now let's face it, you don't think execs with big briefcases are carrying contracts, notepads, and their lunch, now do you? All in all, the wholesalers are figuring this is the stuff you'll want under your tree.